This morning we start a brand new series called Margin. And have you ever felt like your life is so full and so packed and so jammed that it spills over the edges? Like you're too busy? You ever felt like you just need rest and you're not sure when it's going to come? I think that's what this biblical principle of margin is all about. But how would you describe your life? Would you say you have a full life? Would you say you have a busy life? Would you say you have a jam-packed life? Would you say it's go, go, go all the time? I don't know about you, but I look at our days, and our days are planned, and they're scheduled, and they're calendared. We work hard, we play hard, right? That's sort of our American slogan. We're going to work as hard as we can. We're going to play as hard as we can. Every waking moment of our day is filled with tasks and stuff and people from the moment that you wake up until the moment your head hits the pillow, right? 7 days a week, 365 days a year. And we fool ourselves into thinking that we can just go, 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 go all the time, that we can be in that place and it never have any negative impact on us or the people around us at all. And God's Word says it's just not smart. It's just not true. There's a better way to do it. Right? We're busy with home. We're busy with work. We're busy with cooking, with cleaning, with shuttling kids different places. Even our kids have calendars, right? There's this day to run them to dance, or this day to run them to sports, or this Friday is acting class, or they got the drama stuff, or whatever it might be. Do you ever just feel worn out? Even when we take rest, right? Even when you go on vacation, it's let's see how much we can jam into our vacation. Do you ever have those? It's like, well, we got to go here. We got to see this. We're getting ready to go on vacation this week with Katie's family. You guys can pray for us. And there's 15 of us that are all going together. We're staying in one cabin and it should be lots of fun, but we're going to Gatlinburg and we're going to Dollywood right now. Oh yeah. That's right. So Dollywood, it's a theme park for those of you that don't know Dollywood. And so we're going for 2 days to the theme park and 1 day to Splash Country. All right. Now, that sounds like a dream for me with four young kids to walk around the park all day long on rides they can't really ride and push them around. It's going to be great. It's going to be fantastic. But even our vacations, right, are go, 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 and then sometimes, what do you say when you come back from vacation? Man, I need to go back to work to get some rest, right? Yeah. We even think that way in our lives. It reminds me, our lives are sort of like the trash can at home, right? When nobody wants to take it out, when nobody wants to take the garbage out, like they just keep putting one more piece. Oh, we can just fit another thing in. And what do? You just stuff it down, you push it down, and oh yeah, we got a whole other day's worth of capability right here. And so you just add some stuff, and you push it down, and then you add some more, and you push it down. And you think that, you know what, it'll be fine. It won't spill over into every other place of life. Our lives are a lot like that. But I think that we're living right up to the edge all the time. All the time. We just live right up to the edge. It's just mentally, physically, emotionally, everything. We're too busy for anybody's crisis. Have you ever thought about that? Are you too busy for a crisis to happen in your own life? I had a mentor of mine in college, and he said, if you're too busy for a crisis, you're just too busy. Have you thought about what would happen if there was a crisis in your personal life? What would happen if there was a crisis in the life of somebody you love? Would you be able to even address the crisis that's going on with them? Or are we so packed down and so living life to the edges that our whole lives would have to be rearranged because we don't have any space for anything extra? This is what margin is all about. It's this idea of creating space, intentional space, just like the margins in a book. You don't print all the way to the edge. What you do is you leave some room, you leave some boundaries, you create some space. And for us, when we're talking about margin, here's what it means. You can write this down in your notes if you want to, but over the next 4 weeks or 5 weeks, we're going to be talking about what this looks like. But it's creating space for God. Now most of us, we want to create space for us. Right? Like, I need some me time, right? That's one of the phrases we hear. We want to create time for work. We want to create time for family. We want to create time for play. But margin, when we're talking about it, it's creating space for God. Creating space for God for the purpose of hearing from God so then you can be used by God. Now, most of us, when we talk, one of the most common things I hear from church folks all the time is, how do I figure out what God wants me to do? How do I hear God's voice? Like when I'm reading God's word, how do I get something out of that? Like how do I hear Him speak into my life? How do I hear Him speak about what to do with my marriage? How do I hear Him speak about what to do in my home? How do I hear Him speak about what to do at my work? Or how do I hear Him speak about this problem that I have in my life? And how do I get His wisdom to address it? Now here's the thing. Do you think God speaks less today than He did 100 years ago? No. God's still the same God yesterday, today, and forever. But do you think that maybe, just maybe, that we're more busy and more distracted than they were 100 years ago? Right? Now, for us, most of us, we're so busy and so distracted that God could be speaking to us all the time about all of those things. He could be speaking to us about our marriages or about our parenting issue that we're so worried about. Or He could be speaking to us about what to do next at work or how to handle that friendship that person is in real trouble and we really need to reach out and we just don't know what to do. And God could be speaking all the time to us about all of those things, and we're so busy and so distracted and we live lives all the way to the edge that we aren't even able to hear it. We aren't even able to recognize it. And so we're going to talk about creating some margin, some space, some intentional space in our lives just so that we can start to position ourselves to be able to hear and recognize God's voice and then be used by Him. All right? So if you got your Bibles, let's flip open to Exodus chapter 18. We're going to look at a story of a guy who didn't have any margin. Exodus chapter 18. If you don't have your Bibles, that's fine. You can just look on the screen and you can read along with me. Let me give you a little bit of background about what's going on. Moses is the leader of God's people, the nation of Israel. They've been in slavery in Egypt for hundreds of years. And God raises up Moses to lead the people out of Egypt. So they leave Egypt, they leave slavery, and they have around 2 million people that he's leading. So, I mean, that's a big group of people, 2 million people. He's the leader of those folks, and he speaks to God, and God speaks back to him, and then he talks to the people, and he leads them out. And so now they've been led out of Egypt, they've crossed over the Red Sea, and they're at the bottom of the mountain, Mount Sinai. And so they're having all the issues that having 2 million people in the desert, you could imagine what happened. They don't have water. They can't get water. They're trying to find all this. And so they start to complain. And then Moses has to deal with the complaints. And he takes them to God. And God does miracles and provides water and does all these things. But Moses is living life all the way to the edges. And he's doing great things. But his life is totally filled and he has no space. Have you ever felt like that? Let's read and see what's going on with him. Here's what he says. Verse 1. Jethro, the priest of Midian, Moses' father-in-law, heard of all that God had done for Moses and for Israel and his people, and how the Lord had brought Israel out of Egypt. Now Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, had taken Zipporah, Moses' wife, after he had sent her home along with her two sons. The name of one was Gershom, for he said, I've been a sojourner in a foreign land. And the name of the other was Eliezer. And he said, the God of my father was my help and delivered me from the sword of Pharaoh. Now Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, he was a priest over Midian. This is the Midianites. There's a group of people that lived just a little ways away from where the Israelites were camped out. They live right next door to another group of people called the Amalekites. Everybody say Amalekites. Amalekites. Now the people of Israel had just defeated in a battle the Amalekites. Do you remember the story from the scripture? Moses goes up on top of a cliff and he's looking out over the battlefield, and Joshua is leading the battle against the Amalekites. And so Moses, he sees that the Israelites aren't doing so well, right? And so what does he do? He lifts up his hands and he prays to God. God, please, you know, this is your people. You've led us out into this land. You've said you have great plans for us. Please help us win this battle. And so when his hands are raised in praise and worship and honoring of the Lord, the Israelites start to win. Well, what happens? His hands get tired, right? Have you ever tried to hold your hands up? Just everybody hold your hands up right now. You can see it for, I'll let you do it for 30 seconds and you'll see how tired you get. So he has his hands up, right? But they get tired. And so every time his hands go down, the battle is being lost. And it's crazy. It's this weird thing. He's praising God and they win. And then his hands get tired and they start to lose. And so finally they find this rock and they sit him down on this rock. And two guys, Joshua and another guy, because he was fighting the battle, but two of his leaders, they hold up his hands and they make it where they hold him up for him because he literally can't do it anymore. All right, you can put your hands down. So all day long, he's holding his hands up and they win the battle. They win the battle. And so the Midianites, they're right next door to the Amalekites. And so Moses' father-in-law, Jethro, he hears about this battle and he says, "They're here. They're here, baby. Your husband is here with all the people of Israel. Boys, your dad is back. He's here. They finally made it. They've made it out of Egypt." And so he comes and brings Moses' wife and Moses' boys, and he meets them at the bottom of the mountain. Now here's what it says. Verse 5. Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, came with his sons and his wife to Moses in the wilderness when he was encamped at the mountain of God. And when he sent word to Moses, "I, your father-in-law Jethro, am coming to you with your wife and our two sons with her." And Moses went out to meet his father-in-law and bowed down and kissed him. And they asked each other of their welfare and they went into the tent. Now, we don't know exactly how long Moses had been separated from his wife and his kids. We know that she started out to go back to Egypt with Moses when he was going back to set God's people free. But at some point along the way, we don't know if she went back on the journey, if he was nervous about what would happen to her, and for her personal safety, he sends her and the boys back to stay with the father-in-law, or if at some point during the plagues of Egypt, he says, "Listen, Pharaoh might try to take it out on my family," and so he sends his family away. We don't know how long they've been apart. But they've been journeying through the wilderness, I think, for a period of months already. I think almost 3 months, if I'm reading it right. And so it's been at least 3 months since he's seen his wife, and 3 months since he's seen his boys. And then his father-in-law comes, and he's bringing the wife, and he's bringing the boys. Now I want you to see this picture. What would your reaction be if you haven't seen your spouse in 3 months? What would your reaction be if you haven't seen your kids in 3 months? Now, I come home at the end of the day, and thankfully, I still have kids who are little enough, they want to see me still. That's really nice, right? And so I come walking in the door, and my six-year-old, it never fails. She always is waiting for me. She's my sweet one. And she's waiting for me, at least in that moment. And she hears the door unlock and open, and it never fails. I hear her scream to the top of her lungs, "Daddy!" like that, and she tears off running through the house, and she runs and hugs me like it's been 8 years since she's seen me, right? Now, it's only been 8 hours since she's seen me, but she does that every time. Now, I can't imagine being separated for 3 months or 6 months or whatever it might have been. But I want you to see what Moses does. What does he do? This is the life of somebody with no margins, spent all the way to the edges. This, obviously, he was in a crazy place, because who does he kiss? He kisses his father-in-law instead of his wife. All right, now that's a proof that you need margin in your life, for sure, right? You haven't seen your wife in 3 months, and you go and you hug your father-in-law, and you're like, "Honey, I'll see you later. I got to go tell him all about what's been happening," right? Now, I would be thinking that a normal reaction, somebody with margin in their life, would be like, "Good to see you, Jethro. Give me a high five," right? Like, "Let me kiss my wife. Hey, kids, I love you. All right, now, Grandpa, any chance you guys could babysit for a little bit? All right, we're going to go over here, and I'm going to tell my wife all about what's been happening for 3 months," right? But no, that wasn't Moses' reaction. Now I want you to see what happens. Verse 8. "Then Moses told his father-in-law all that the Lord had done to Pharaoh and to the Egyptians for all Israel's sake, and all the hardship that had come upon them in the way, and how the Lord had delivered him." Listen, this is like just a sermon within a sermon right here, but when you're sharing your testimony with people, and when you're sharing your faith with other people, there's times where the church tries to sugarcoat the message of Jesus. Isn't that true? The church talks about it, and especially on television, people talk about relationship with Jesus, and they make it appear that when you know Jesus, like, all of life just instantly better, right? You get a bigger, better life. a bigger, better house, a bigger, better salary, like all these things. And that is so not the gospel. That's not anything Jesus promises. He promises His constant presence and peace regardless of what you're going through in your life. He promises a life that is otherworldly. He says it doesn't matter what hardships you go through in this world, I'll be there right by your side, and I'll be able to take even things that are against you for evil and work them out for your good. But He doesn't promise that everything is going to be good, does He? And here's Moses, and he shares all the great things of God. Now, if you're sharing this story, it would be really easy to just share, did you hear what happened when God sent the 10 plagues? And boy, He just booted them out. Like, it was amazing. Did you see God's power and how that worked? But He also shares the hardships. I've got 2 million people, and they're questioning me in the desert. I've got 2 million people who are saying, did God forget us about us out here? Did He lead us out of this place so we could all die in the desert? Like, He totally tells the good and the bad. And He says, but God has been with him through it all. Now look what He says. It keeps going. Verse 9. And Jethro rejoiced for all the good that the Lord had done in Israel, and then He delivered them out of the hand of the Egyptians. And Jethro said, blessed be the Lord who has delivered you out of the hand of the Egyptians and out of the hand of Pharaoh, and has delivered the people from under the hand of the Egyptians. This word rejoice, it means he literally gets super excited. He gets joyful. He becomes glad. He's thankful in the presence of God. Have you ever heard a story that you're almost more excited than the person telling it? Like somebody comes and they tell you great news, right? Like you hear that somebody is pregnant, or you hear that there's great news about somebody just got a house, or there's great news in somebody else's life, or they talk about something that God has done. They restored a relationship that was broken and now they're friends again. Like, have you ever been just as excited as that other person was? That's what Jethro is feeling. He looks at it and he says, I can't believe all that God has done for you. I remember when you were just shepherding my sheep. Do you remember? And you went to that mountain and you saw the bush that was on fire, and you said you talked to God, and I thought you were crazy. And you said you had to go back down to Egypt, and I thought that was a crazy thing too. And you went and you said you were going to lead an entire nation. You, this one guy with your God that I couldn't see, you were going to lead this whole nation, 2 million people, out of slavery against the most powerful man on the planet, the Pharaoh, the king of all kings. And it was just going to be you and your God, and you were going to lead them out, and here you are. I can't believe that your God did this. This is incredible. He's so excited. Now look what it says, verse 11. Now I know the Lord is greater than all gods, because in this affair they dealt arrogantly with the people. He looks at him and he says, your God, the word he uses for God is Yahweh. The I am that I am. He's always been. He exists now. He always will be. He says, the God that you met on the mountain, Moses, I now see what He's done, and I believe that He's the only true God. Now, who's the guy who's saying this? What was his title? Look back at verse 1. He's the priest of Midian. All right, Midian didn't believe in Yahweh. Midian had lots of pagan false gods that they worshiped. And what was he doing? He's a priest. He's not just worshiping these false gods. He's leading other people in worship of these other gods. But he looks and he sees what the one true God, Yahweh, has done for Moses and all the people of Israel. And he's like, I guess I'm out of a job. I don't know. Like, I was a priest that led other people in worship of false gods. But now I look at what happened with you, and I see what your God has done, and He's the one who is, and He's the one who was, and He's the one who will be. There's no other God like Him. He's above every other God. And he worships. Now look what it says, verse 12. And so Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, brought a burnt offering and sacrifices to God. And Aaron came with all the elders of Israel to eat bread with Moses' father-in-law before God. So they sit down and they say, listen, we're just so glad about who God is. Let's eat in His presence. Let's just share a meal and let's just celebrate who God is and what He's done. And Jethro leads the entire congregation of Israel in this. Now look what it says, verse 13. The next day, Moses set to judge the people. And the people stood around Moses from morning until evening. And when Moses, his father-in-law, saw all that he was doing for the people, he said, "What is this thing that you're doing for the people? Why do you sit alone and all the people stand around you from morning until evening?" Now, here's what would happen. Moses was not just the political leader. He was the spiritual leader. And he was the governmental leader. And so Moses was the only one who could tell them and decide as a judge about any case that was going on. So you can imagine, look right here, in 2 million people, you're going to have some conflict, right? 2 million people camping out in the desert, you're going to have some conflicts that go on, right? Like, "Your livestock did this to me. Gladys's donkey has been eating my begonias. I can't believe this." Whatever it is, right? Like, there's conflict that's going on. "You stole this. You did this." Now, I want you to imagine, now, Mooresville is a small town, but have you ever been to the courthouse? I want to tell you, you can sit there all day long and hear lots of cases about what's going on, about somebody stole this or burgled this or somebody did this or whatever it is. There's cases all day long in our little small town. Now, can you imagine a town of 2 million people and all of the conflicts that happen there, and there's only one judge? Imagine what that would be like. Now here's Moses, 2 million people coming to him with their problems. Can you imagine shouldering that load? The load of 2 million people, they've got a problem, they can't solve it. Where do they go? Well, I guess we go to Moses. And so from morning, as soon as the sun was up, until the sun went down, Moses is sitting there. And they would all bring their problems, and they would bring their cases, and they would say them to him, and he would be the one to say, "Okay, well, let me talk to God. I'll figure that out. Hold on. Is it a spiritual question? Let me talk to God about it. Is it a law question? We don't have the law yet. We're a brand new nation. We don't have any laws. Let me talk to God about what His thoughts are about that." And so he would talk to God, and then he would teach the people and say, "Well, this is the law now. From sun up till sundown, every single day." Can you imagine that? Now, I want you to put yourself in this place, right? Now, how many of you get phone calls from family members? Everybody's got a family member that's the drama person, right? Do y'all have those? I don't have one because they watch these YouTubes. So, no, nobody in my family is like that, I promise. But I'm sure all of you have one person that is like the drama person, right? And everything in their life is just an ordeal, right? Have you ever met these people? It's like, "You won't believe the other day what happened. I got up and I got a paper cut. Oh, it stung so bad," right? You know, you'll never believe how my boss spoke to me. And it's like, at some point, after you hear over and over and over and over and over and over these problems, you almost want to look back at them and say, "That's why they're called your problems, because they're yours and nobody else's." Like, bottle that up a little bit, right? Now, can you imagine all you ever hear is the problems of 2 million people? Like, nobody's coming to the judgment thing to be like, "Moses, you'll never believe it. Something great happened the other day. Like, you won't believe it. Like, I was there and we had this conflict and we got it resolved. Isn't that great, Moses?" Nobody's doing that. All he ever hears is the drama of 2 million people from sun up to sundown. Now, can you imagine how exhausting that would be? And his father-in-law just sits and watches and observes, and he looks at his life. Moses' life is going all the way to the edge of the pages. Like, there's no margin around for anything. All day long, from sun up to sundown, he's just sitting there, listening to people, consulting God. "God, what do you want me to do?" And there's no way out. There's no end in sight. And so look at his father-in-law. He says, "Why do you just sit there all day long? Why do you do that? What's going on? Tell me all about that." I love it. His father-in-law is playing dumb. Have you ever done that? You ever play dumb with people? Tell me more about that. What's going on? You know, his father-in-law knows, but dad sees, he's doing a great tactic. He sees, he observes, and then he goes and he asks. He could have just gone to Moses and be like, "Moses, you're ridiculous. Like, Moses, seriously? You think you're the only guy that can solve people's problems? What's wrong with you? Like, you're so out of it, you even hugged me instead of hugging your wife. Like, what's your problem? Like, get it together, Moses. Come on, like, schedule other people to sit down for you." Like, but he doesn't. He sees the problem, he goes to Moses, and he asks Moses questions so that Moses can draw his own conclusions. So look what he says. Verse 15, Moses said to his father-in-law, "Well, because the people come to me to inquire of God. And when they have a dispute, they come to me and I decide between one person and another. And I make known to them the statutes of God and all of His laws. Moses is, what do you mean? What's the problem? What's the problem? I'm doing great things. What do you mean? Why would I sit there? Because people need me. Why would I do that? Because these people have problems. Why would I do that? Because I'm the one who speaks closest to God. And they're coming to me and they're asking me for stuff. And so it's on me. Like, if I don't do it, who's going to do it? I mean, I'm here and I'm talking to God. And besides, this is my role. This is what I'm supposed to do. I'm the leader guy. I'm the one who hears people's problems. I'm the one who helps them out. I'm the one who talks to God. I'm the one who teaches the people about what God thinks. Like, I'm living in the sweet spot of, I'm doing exactly what I'm made to do. What do you mean? What's the problem? What's the problem? Now look at what he says. Verse 17. I love this. Moses' father-in-law said to him, "What you're doing is not good." What do you mean it's not good? Verse 18, he says, "You and the people with you will certainly wear yourselves out, for the thing is too heavy for you, and you're not able to do it alone." Listen, this is most of our defense, right? Whenever we look at something and we say, oh, we need more time with God. We need to create more margin in our lives. We need more space. Most of our defense is, well, what am I going to cut out? I'm doing lots of great stuff. I mean, like, there's only so many hours in the day, and I've got to do this with my kids, and I've got to do this with work, and I've got to do this with church, and I've got to do this with my family, I've got to do this with my neighbors, and somebody's got to mow the grass, and I need to work out. We've got to take care of our bodies, right? And I need to coach, and I need to do this, and I've got to have quiet time. And so, and all these things, what am I supposed to cut out here? Listen, I'm doing all good stuff. I'm doing stuff I enjoy, right? Some of us who are workaholic, some of you in this room, like, you just work, and you're like, but I love it. It doesn't even feel like work, right? That was sort of the way Moses was thinking. But write this down. Here's what Jethro tells him. This is a great principle for margin. He says, hey, Moses, too much of even a good thing is not good. Too much of even a good thing is not good. He says, you're doing great stuff, Moses. I mean, you're teaching people, right? It's a great thing to teach people God's law. You're hearing people's problems. Moses, that's great. You're helping people solve their problems. Moses, you're there and you're in the sweet spot. Like, you're doing exactly what God has created you to do, but you're doing it all the time, all the way to the edges. You have no room in your life, and you're going to wear yourself out, and you're going to wear the people out. Have you ever seen this happen? We've got terms for it in our culture, right? We call it burnout. We call it fizzle out. We say people just need a mental break, right? Like, hopefully for most of us, it happens before we have to go to the padded room over at Broughton. Like, you know, I mean, this is a deal where for most of us, we work, and then we say, oh, vacation is coming. Oh, the day off is coming. Or it happens where we just get sick because we don't take care of ourselves. And God's like, I'll just build you some margin in while you're sitting in a hospital bed. That sounds great, right? And so we live our lives and we say, but we're doing good stuff. And Jethro looks at him and he says, listen, too much of even a good thing is not good. It's not good. You're going to wear yourself out. This word wear yourself out means crumble, wither, decay. You're going to burn out. You're going to lose it. You're going to snap. He says, you're like a rubber band, Moses, right? It's good to be stretched, not good to be broken. He says, you're doing so much of a good thing, even though it's good. You don't have any margin in your life. You just stretch. And eventually, Moses, you're going to snap because you're good. But you're not that good. Nobody's that good. It's too much for any one person, Moses. Listen, I want to tell you right now, ladies, you're not that good. I mean, you're good, but you're not that good. You can't bear all of those things alone. You can't shoulder all of those responsibilities alone. All the things that you do, you can't keep doing them over and over and over and living life all the way to the edge and you got no margin. And well, yeah, but it has to get done. Well, but my kids have to have dinner. Oh, yeah, but I have to have the laundry. Oh, I got to work. I got to make sure that I get our vacation money set aside. Whatever it is. Ladies, listen, I want to tell you, but there's another friend and she needs my help. And you should hear what's going on in her life. And listen, I got to live my life. And I want to tell you, you can live your life all the way to the edge, and eventually you're not going to be good enough to maintain it. Nobody's that good. You got to have some margin. Guys, it's the same for you. I got to work. I mean, I got college coming for my kids. Like, I got to get that college fund ready. Listen, I got to do this. I've got to be here. These kids need me. These sports things need me. I got to be here. I got to use my talents. Got to use my gifts. I got to go here. Got to do this. Got to do that. Then I got to be a dad. And then I got to be a worker. And then I got to be a leader. And then I got to do this. And he said, all those things are great. But if you're not creating margin around your life, you're not that good. Nobody's that good. You can't bear it alone. You need to create some space so that you can position yourself to hear from God and be restored by God and then be used by God, right? This is why we have elders at the church. This is why our church is set up in C groups so people can care for one another. This is why we do things the way we do, because nobody can do it alone. We're supposed to be community together, knowing community, loving through community, living in community. Now, Moses could have gotten defensive. Who are you, pagan priest? Hey, you just came to be believing in God, what, like 6 months ago, 6 weeks ago, 6 minutes ago? Like, I've been leading God's people for how long now? Yeah, take that advice and just get on back to Midian. Thanks for dropping the wife and kids off. Hope the donkey gives you a great ride home, right? But he doesn't. He takes this advice. And look at what Jethro says, verse 19. Now, obey my voice, I'll give you advice, and God will be with you. You shall represent the people before God and bring their cases to God, and you shall warn them about their statutes and law and make them know the way in which they must walk and must do. Moreover, look for able men from all the people, men who fear God, who are trustworthy and hate a bribe, and place such men over the people as chiefs of thousands, hundreds, fifties, and tens, and let them judge the people at all times. Every great matter they shall bring to you, but any small matter they'll decide themselves. So it'll be easier for you, and they'll bear the burden with you. He says, here's what you do, Moses. Up to this point, you've been teaching the people and hearing people's problems. And here's what you're going to do after this point. You're going to be teaching people and hearing people's problems. Moses is like, wait a minute, I thought this was the same thing. Like, that's what I'm doing right now. And he's like, yeah, but now you're going to do it with margin. You're going to create some space by empowering other people to help you. And so you're going to keep doing what you're doing, but you're not going to do it from sun up to sundown and wear yourself out. You're not going to wear yourself out. You're not going to make everybody's life around you chaotic because of your craziness. And he says, instead, you're going to have margin in your life. Look what he says, verse 23. Here's three promises about setting up margin. Here's what it is. Listen to these three promises. It's amazing. He says, if you do this, number one, God will direct you. God will direct you. Anybody looking for direction from God when it comes to your marriage? Anybody looking for direction from God when it comes to your parenting? Anybody looking for direction from God about what to do with your job or what to do with that friendship or whatever it is? Anybody looking for direction from God about how to handle your finances? Anybody looking for direction from God about how to grow as a person? Or anybody looking for direction from God about anything in your life? Start to live with margin. It's a promise. You do this, you're going to have direction from God. But that's not all. Look at what it says. Number two, you'll be able to endure. You'll be able to endure. This word endure, it means you'll be able to stand up and remain standing. Like, we don't want to fizzle out, right? As a people, as a church, we don't want to go a great long way in our marriage and then burn out when we're 65. Right? We don't want to burn out as a parent, as a grandparent. We don't want to be fighting and fighting and going all this way and like, woo, look at the ground we've taken for God, just to be at this place where we're like, and now we're dead. Right? That's not what we want. We want to endure. We want to be able to make our stand and then stay standing. That's what his promise is to Moses. He says, Moses, you set up this margin in your life. You're going to have direction from God, but then you're also going to endure. Now, don't you want to endure in your marriage? Don't you want to endure as a parent, as a grandparent? Don't you want to endure in your friendships? Don't you want to endure in your finances? Don't you want to endure at work? It won't happen unless you start to set up some margin, right? Now look at the third promise. Here's what he says. If you do this, God will direct you. You'll be able to endure. And all this people will go to their place in what? Peace. Peace. All right, so it's God's direction for you. Endurance for you, and peace for those around you. And let me ask you this. Has your living right up to the edge impacted your kids? Absolutely. As you're living right over the margins of life, like you're just bleeding through, all the way through the margin, not creating space, not creating good boundaries, not creating good space. Has that affected your marriage? Absolutely. It has to. Has it affected your friendships? Has it affected your church? Has it affected you personally? Yes. He says, his advice to Moses was, you can't keep doing this. It's going to affect you. And everybody else is going to get mad at you eventually because they're going to say, I don't want to wait 6 months to get a meeting with you. I don't want to wait 6 weeks until, Dad, you can actually listen to a story without being on your phone and answering 5,000 emails. I don't want to wait to have a conversation with you till at night, honey, when you're sitting there and you're so exhausted from the day, all you want to do is, what's on TV, babe? Oh, are you talking to me? Right? Like, I want to have a conversation with you when you're coherent, when you can listen, right? He says people are going to be upset. It doesn't have a possibility that you can live life through the margins and it not affect you and everybody around you. But if you live with margins, God's direction for you, endurance for you, and peace for those around you. Who doesn't want that? Who doesn't want their marriage to be at peace? Because you've strategically created space to hear from God and be ready to be used by God in your marriage. Who doesn't want their parenting to create peace for their kids and their grandkids? Because you're strategically carving out time in your life to hear from God and to be used by God and your parents. Who doesn't want their friendships to have peace? Because they're hearing from God about their friends and they're going to be used by God and their friends. Who doesn't want their work to be at peace? You see, he says, you can live your life all the way through the edges and you can go, 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 go. And then one day, it's going to catch up to you and everybody around you. Or, you can create some margin. You create space, you position yourself to hear from God so you can be used by God, and then God will direct you. God will direct you and you'll endure, and it'll be peace for those that are around you. Seems like a pretty good deal. Look what it says, verse 24. So Moses listened to the voice of his father-in-law and did all that he had said. And Moses chose able men out of all of Israel and made them heads over the people, chiefs of thousands, hundreds, fifties, and tens. And they judged the people at all times. Any hard case they brought to Moses, but any small matter they decided themselves. And Moses let his father-in-law depart, and he went away to his own country. Let me ask you really quick, just closing today. How much margin do you currently have in your life? Or are you so busy, so distracted, so living life, work, work, play, play, family, family, all these other things, and you're filled with stuff all the time from the moment you get up to the moment that you close your eyes at night. And God may be speaking to you, and He wants to give you direction. And you feel so tired, and you feel so weary, and you feel emotionally drained, and physically drained, and spiritually drained, and God's like, no wonder you're living life all the way to the edges. And I want you to have some margin in your life. I want to give you endurance instead of you feeling exhausted all the time. Listen, are those around you experiencing the peace that comes from a margin-filled life? From their husband? From their wife? From their kids? Like, are they experiencing that? Or is the chaos of your life, the go, 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 we got to get more done, we can do this, we can, even if it's good stuff, right? Too much of a good thing, even a good thing is not good. Do they experience the chaos or the peace that comes from your life? Over the next several weeks, we're going to talk about some specific ways, all right, that you can have margin in your life. And so don't miss these. If you have to go out of town on vacation to get some margin, then make sure that you download the YouTube video and make sure you watch the stuff as we go. But here's what I want to ask you today. Are you setting yourself up for a fall? Because of how you schedule your life and you plan your life, like, are you go, 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 go? Are you positioning yourself to hear from God? Are you just saying, man, I'd love direction? Man, I would love some endurance right now. I would love for my family to have peace. But then, are you still bleeding through the margins? Right? Listen, I want you to commit that you're going to hear from God. As a pastor, I so want you to be able to have space in your life where you can hear from Him. I so want you to have this place in your life where you order your life in such a way that you're able to endure as a dad, that you're able to endure as a mom, as a wife, as a husband, that you can endure as a parent, that you can endure as the best worker at that business, that you can endure as the most amazing friend or neighbor possible. I with everything in me, I want to see your families filled with peace because you've created those boundaries of margin in your life and you're living that way. You're hearing from God and you're getting direction from Him and you're enduring in the peace that comes from that for your family and your friends. That's what I so want for you. That's what I want for myself. And so I'm just going to ask you, would you just take a look at your life and say, am I bleeding through the margins? Or do I need to change some things? And over the next few weeks, whatever you tell me to change, God, I'll do it. Whatever you tell me to change for my marriage, for me, for my kids, for whoever, even if it's tough, even if it's abandoning something I love, something that I feel like, man, that's my sweet spot. If you tell me, I'll do it because I want to make sure that I'm ready to hear from you and have direction and I can endure. And my people around me have peace. Let's pray. This is something that we so desperately need as a church. I honestly believe the reason we don't hear more from God as a people, the reason that we are seeking direction but sometimes not finding it in our marriages or in our parenting or any area in life is because we've scheduled and made ourselves so busy with activities and even good things all the way to the edges of life, and we're so distracted that we can't hear from Him even when He's speaking so loudly. This morning, if you would just say, yeah, the Holy Spirit's really showing me. I need some margin in my life. I need some margin for the sake of myself and my health. I need some margin for the sake of my marriage. I need some margin for the sake of my kids or my work or other things. And God, I'm willing to do whatever it is that you want me to do, whatever you want me to change, however you want me to, even if it's just a thought process. Maybe it's changing every day, and instead of getting in the car and blasting something on the radio, maybe you just have the radio off as you drive into work, and that's your margin where you can hear from God about your marriage and your family, and He can help you have strength to endure, and you get your peace for all those around you. Maybe it's every day in the shower. You just are intentional about, okay, the shower is my place where I'm going to be seeking to position myself to hear from God about my life, about my marriage, about my spiritual walk, about all these things. I'm ready to hear God. If you have anything to say, you can say it now. Maybe it's every night after dinner. Maybe instead of watching TV for 2 hours before you go to bed, maybe you watch one show and then you sit together with your spouse and you say, let's just spend some time praying. Let's pray for our direction as parents. Let's spend some time listening to God about His direction for us. Maybe that's your margin. Whatever the Lord tells you to do over the next several weeks, if you feel like, you know what, I'm setting myself up, I need to change, I need something to change, then I'm just going to ask you, as we sing this song, I'm just going to ask you to come down front and pray and just say, God, I'm here. Too much of my life is like Moses, filled to the edges, so distracted I'm not even thinking about hearing from you as much as I should. But God, I want your direction. God, I want your endurance. And I want peace for those around me because I'm living a life with margin. If that's the cry of your heart and God's just spoken to you about that, I'm just going to ask everybody to stand. And as everyone stands, if that's the cry of your heart like it is for me, I'm going to be up front praying that. That's what I want for my family, my kids, my marriage. Would you just stand? And if the Lord's told you to come, you just come and pray as we sing. And then we're going to celebrate together these things that God's going to teach us.